Good evening to one and all present here. Today, we all have gathered here for panel discussion, moderated by Toastmaster Kavita and distinguished Toastmaster Winston D'Souza. Panel discussion, what is it? For those who are attending it for the first time, I would like to explain it in few words. A panel discussion, or simply a panel, involves a group of people gathered to discuss a topic in front of an audience. A panel discussion is typically facilitated by a skilled panel moderator who guides the panel and audience through a lively conversation about a specific topic. Now, the panelists are a group of people, typically 3 to 4 experts or practitioners in the field, who share facts, offer opinions, and respond to audience questions, either through questions curated by moderator or taken from the audience directly. Now, after the panel discussions, if our audience, you have any doubt, you can put your questions in the chat box. Our moderator will ask them to the panelists at the end during Q&A session. So without much ado, let us start our first panel discussion, which is moderated by none other than beautiful, intelligent Toastmaster, Toastmaster Kavita. A reflection on body, mind, and soul during the pandemic. Over to you, our moderator, Toastmaster Kavita.
Thank you, Shraddha. Good evening, everyone. I welcome you all to a discussion on the reflection of mind, body, and soul during the pandemic. Healing and a feeling of person homeless only occurs when the mind, body, and spirit are in balance. Balancing them all is necessary for a happy and fun-filled life. And in the moments of crisis, especially during this pandemic, it is vital for you to be vigilant in protecting that balance. All the three are connected: the mind, body, and soul. As we all know that a healthy body keeps you well and active, we have invited 3 esteemed panelists to provide us their insights and answer some of our questions as to how to cope with COVID-19, which has brought us its way. The topic today is the reflection of body, mind, and soul during pandemic. I, Kavita Kamath, will be the moderator of today's panel discussion. Let me share with you a brief introduction of the panelists. A law graduate from the prestigious Bangalore University, an MS in counseling and psychotherapy, Mrs. Radha Bhatt has a vast experience to her credit from teaching school children and Gizan International School, Saudi Arabia. As at the counselor at Manaswini Clinic, Mangalore, Santati Center for Reproductive Medicine, student counselor at St. Aloysius Higher Primary School, member of the Ethics Committee at the Manipal Dental College. And from 2006, she has a private practice at Pragati Counseling Center till date. Known for her extensive knowledge of offering giving to clients, her competency is the patience and person-centered approach and awareness of policies and procedures. It is a pleasure to present to you Mrs. Radha Bhatt, the well-known counselor and psychotherapist of Mangalore, one of our esteemed panelists today. Welcome, madam.
Thank you, Kavita.
Welcome. We have with us a multifaceted personality, a grammar enthusiastic, a lover of nature, a fun-loving and a bubbly person, our very own member of MTM. By now you must have guessed. Anyway, she is already on the screen. Mrs. Pratibha Kamath. She has an MSc PGDPN Nutrition and Dietetics from Mumbai University. She's an ex-nutrition counselor and dietetics. It's indeed a privilege to present to you the charming Mrs. Pratibha Kamath. Welcome, Pratibha. A serene person that she is, she has to her credit the education of yoga from the Annamalai University. Yoga Darshanam, Mysore. PYA Academy, Delhi. Completed 500 hours in teaching training course in yoga, Pilates, and personal trainers course with the Indian Academy of Fitness Training, Mangalore. Associated in the airline and IT industry as well. It's a privilege to introduce to you a travel enthusiastic who loves to socialize with a zeal to make our country a healthier one, Mrs. Reshma Kariyappa, the fitness consultant and yoga instructor, one of our esteemed panelists for today. Welcome, Reshma. A question that I thought would hold good for all the panelists. I go ahead with my first question for you all. Do you think this pandemic and the subsequent lockdown has brought about a change in the way we, the people, reflect about our mind, body, and soul? We are waiting to listen to your valuable thoughts one by one on mind, body, and soul. Over to the gracious threesome.
Definitely, yes. The term pandemic, lockdown, curfew, work from home, social distancing were new to us. As famous Greek philosopher Aristotle said, man is by nature a social animal. An individual who is unsocial and naturally and not accidentally is either beneath our notice or more than human. People started noticing that the priorities were changing from basic needs like food, clothing, shelter, etc., towards reassurance, security, warmth, comfort, belongingness, etc. We started giving importance to family time, bonding virtually with family and friends, started cultivating new hobbies, started to appreciate small little pleasures in day-to-day life. Basically, we all started to cater to the inner child within us, started working towards our emotional well-being. Finally, thank you.
Thank you, Radha.
Yes, hello everybody. To your question, Kavita, I would like to answer that the biggest change this pandemic of lockdown has brought about is to put health under the spotlight. Just see around us at a personal level, family level, city level, even the whole world level, all decisions, news, everything is based on something about the health. We are making huge changes in our life. We are shutting down cities, schools, malls, everything for the sake of not catching an infection. So that's how huge health has become. So when you talk about health, definitely food will also come in. And as a nutritionist, I'm seeing in this pandemic and lockdown, there's a huge buzz around good food eating habits, healthy living, etc. I'm sure you get a lot of forwards in your phone every day about tips on what to do to boost immunity, what to eat to get a healthy lifestyle and all that. So there is a lot of buzz around healthy eating and thereby getting natural immunity. So I would say this pandemic and lockdown, although it's been a horrible experience for all of us, the silver lining is that we have all become a little more attuned to staying healthy. So this discussion proves it. We are all discussing that now. So over to you, Kavita.
Thank you, Pratibha.
Yes, definitely it has brought a lot of changes, change in us. As we all know, yoga is an age-old medicine which has been passed on to us by our ancestor. And knowing the benefit of yoga, Modi ji started the International Yoga Day. And because of that, you know, worldwide people started recognizing yoga. So people who have been actually practicing yoga before the pandemic and also continued practicing it during the pandemic, for me, I felt they were able to accept the challenge, the change in a more positive manner. I think they started, yoga helped them to find that, inner happiness. They found an inner peace within themselves. It gave them a great sense of relaxation physically, creating a space mentally as well as spiritually. In other words, yoga is actually a union between mind, body, and soul. Yes.
Thank you, Reshma. We had valid points from all the three panelists. I agree that we learn to have that strong bonding, that inner peace and that belongingness in each one of us. This pandemic has taught us many things. I agree to your insights. I couldn't have agreed for more. Now let's move on for some more questions to our panelists. Now I'm going to ask you a question individually. I have a question for you, Mrs. Bhatt. During this pandemic, our focus was on health, eating good food, cooking in the house, and so on. But the mind got completely neglected. What are the major challenges during the pandemic? Over to you, Mrs. Radha Bhatt.
The major challenges were actually time management, communication, and too much of physical time without space between individuals. Actually, I would like to touch on different age groups so that we can have a bird's view of the challenges faced. And these are the common issues which I regularly see in my clinics as well. So I just wanted to have brief about it. In the younger children, the small toddlers, absolutely without any human interaction, playtime with their peers in open playground with other children, have left them with very poor interactive skills. Next is the school-going children. They are forced to stay indoors with online education, which in turn have completely turned them these kids into online addicts, virtual media, living in a false fantasy world. Young working adults, too much work pressure, lack of exercise, binge eating, poor sleep and wake up cycle have contributed to anxiety, poor performance. Now, the married couples, even though initially it was welcomed with a lot of excitement, too much physical time started invading their privacy, work pressure increased, even small shortcomings were highlighted, which triggered fights between the couples, again, due to frustration of not having outlets. Now, the senior citizens, families with senior citizens have curtailed their free time, their socializing, walks, due to the fear of pandemic and its complication on adults. Somewhere down the line, people initially focused only on physical health without mental health, that without realizing mental health too needs priority. We all need interaction, socializing. It gives us a security of belongingness, communication, helps us to ventilate our feelings. I would just like to add, it's okay to feel overwhelmed with emotion. It's okay to feel sad, angry, frustrated. Just reason it out and remember, when going gets tough, the tough gets going. And remember, this too shall pass. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mrs. Bhatt. I do agree, it is all within us how we need to incorporate good practices and move on. I really enjoyed the way you explained in detail each group of each age group, right from the child to the adult or the senior citizen, I would say. It was very clearly mentioned. Thank you on that note. Next in line, we have Pratibha. Pratibha, in your opinion, what are the easy and simple ways to incorporate good practices in our daily life with regards to nutrition?
Okay. So you said easy and good practices. I know a very easy mantra for all of you all to enjoy good health and good nutrition. Be simple. Okay. This pandemic has taught us, if not anything, to simplify our lives, doesn't it? Most of us have abandoned our cars and started walking because cars are not allowed on the roads. Most of us are wearing simple clothes at home because there's no law. So please be simple in your eating habits too. I've seen so many families who have stopped going out so often because they have learned to cook at home. Young girls and boys have learned to cook at home. So the main thing is to be simple. And in today's complicated world of ours, being simple is the most difficult thing to do. So that is why we have all these nutrient problems. But I'll put it in a nutshell for you, some good practices which you can follow. First is eat well and eat often. That's very important. Second, eat home-cooked food most of the times. I'm not telling you to eat home-cooked food all the times. We all feel like going out. But for every 10 or 12 home-cooked meals, you can go out once. Keep a sort of ratio like that. So that we all know why home-cooked food versus hotel food is, you know, the difference between all that. And then eat seasonal. Don't shy away from eating that mango, even if you're diabetic or whatever, or even if you have any, whichever fruit is seasonal, please do eat it, because nature has intended us to eat seasonal fruits, and the weather is in such a way that, you know, we can digest it and, you know, assimilate it, and we get good nutrients out of it, good nutrition. Eat local. Try to eat local foods, because for the same reason, the air, the water, everything in our local environment helps us to digest and assimilate the food better. Don't go for exotic quinoa or some dragon fruit, or, you know, thinking that it's more nutritious. So eat local. Eat fresh. Try not to get the vegetables and keep it in fridge. As soon as you bring it every day, prepare it. Just see how tasty it becomes. Eat a variety. When you go to buy vegetables and fruits, please focus on getting as much variety as possible to bring it home so that you cook it. Eat small portions. Less is more, less is more, less is more. Keep saying that, because we don't work like people who work on the road or anything. We are very, for a small, even to clean the fan, we'll call our maid, or to clean anything which is physical activity, we depend on others. So since you are not doing too much physical activity, eat small portions of everything, okay? And burn more than you eat. If you follow that principle, burn more than you eat, then you can eat anything, actually. So, bas itna karo, then there's no need to follow any special diet. So, these are all very simple nuskas. And that is the only way. Try to love your body more and not love only this tongue part of yours, because we give a lot of importance to that 1-inch part of our tongue. Please care about your liver and pancreas and colon and everything. So, when you eat hot, spicy Chinese food, give a thought to that poor liver or that pancreas which has to digest that spicy and, you know, acidic food. You should say sorry to it and say, I'm sorry, I'm eating it, but I'll try not to eat more. So please love your body and be simple and follow all this. I would have spoken a lot more, but for paucity of time, I'll stop here. And I hope you can add some questions in the chat box if you have any doubts, or later too. Over to you, Kavita.
Thank you so much, Pratibha. It was very enriching, the message what you conveyed to us, that we need to eat healthy food and we have to keep ourselves fit by eating small portions, more portions and small portions. I do agree with you, and we'll keep in note to keep ourselves healthy with better diet, and also eat seasonal fruits which are available around us. Thank you on the insights. Can we have the next panelist, and that is Reshma with us. Reshma, your question is, increased screen time and being seated in small space causing physical and mental damage and insomnia. Reshma, how can yoga be of help here? Could you elaborate on this? Over to you.
Yes, Kavita. So the present scenario is such that, you know, all of us are using gadgets. It can be for work, for entertainment, or for the children are using for their online classes. So I think we need to consciously make that attempt to, you know, create, you know, cut that flow and, you know, try to adapt yoga in a daily practice. I'm not saying that, you know, we have to, like, you know, do a strenuous kind of asana or, you know, spend 1 hour of your time on your mat. But, you know, you just take about 15 minutes of your time, get onto the mat and, you know, a very simple, like, you know, you can just do a simple movement, you know, you could give to your neck, to your shoulders, which will just, you know, increase the blood flow to your joints and all that aches and pains that we've been experiencing, you know, sitting in front of our computer. It will just, you know, relieve you of that. You can, you know, give that, you know, palming to your eyes, which will, you know, relax your eyes instantly. There are other things also. Yoga is not only about asanas, but it is also about, like we know, it is about your mudras and meditation. So maybe the next day you want to change, you know, because we get bored of, you know, the same thing over and over again. So if you want the next day, you do, you know, adapt a mudra, sit in a meditative pose. It can be on the floor. If you're not comfortable, you could sit on a sofa, you know, meditate. So this helps you to connect with the present self, you know, and helps you to quieten your mind also through meditation. And then you have the pranayama, the breathing, we know, you know, the breathing practices that we do. So a lot of people now, because of the pandemic, have been complaining about sleeplessness. So, you know, you kind of, the Brahmari. The Brahmari is one kind of a pranayama, which you can adapt just 5 minutes before sleeping and get into your shavasana, that is lying down in the corpse position and, you know, scanning your body from toe, head to toe. And, you know, I think it will, it just benefits you and gives you that, you know, relaxed kind of a peacefulness throughout your body. I would like to end it. You know, yoga not necessarily changes everything in you, but it definitely has a potential to do so. The only thing is you need to accept it with open hands. So if you do so, yoga is definitely a magic. Yes, thank you.
Thank you, Reshma, for those inputs. I do agree with you and the way you've explained us about yoga and meditation. We need to accept it and we have to change our lifestyles into better and healthy lives. We have to, you know, incorporate a healthy life and during this pandemic, so that if we exercise and meditate, we'll have a better lifestyle. So thank you for your inputs, Reshma. Thank each one of you who have given your inputs. Each one of us have faced one or more challenge during this pandemic. Your thoughts and view have been of great help to each one of us present here today. Let's turn the floor over to the audience. I'm sure the audience are waiting to put their questions in the chat box. I request and request each one of you, whoever has questions, could you are open to put your questions in the chat box. Due to the paucity of time, we would take another 10 minutes for the Q&A session and then your questions will be answered later in your chat box or your WhatsApp group. So let's take the first question for today. Just give me a moment. So we have a question from our very own Toastmaster Sharmila Sagar. She is requesting one of the panelists to answer this question. What are the ways to ward off untimely food cravings, especially the junk food?
Yeah, I think that question is meant for me, right, Kavita?
Yeah, Pratika.
Okay.
It's very much.
Yeah, it's a very good question, because most of the time when people tell me, what should I eat? I tell them, the advice is not what should eat. You should eat. Everybody knows that. It's what you should not eat. That is the bigger question, you know, because most of our diet is faulty because of what we should not eat. But as she said as you asked, Sharmila, that untimely food cravings are common for all of us, especially now in the days of Swiggy and Zomato sending us notifications saying there's a 60% off on some Lazy's pizza and one get one free ghee roast. Oh my God, when you read that in your notification, instantly your mouth waters and we are like, you know, all the nutrition gyan that we have go out of the roof. So the first thing is that you, to avoid food cravings, you get food cravings when you're hungry. So try, my first advice is not to remain hungry. Try to eat food on time. Try to eat food regularly. Try to eat good, well portion sizes. You have normally seen in the house, if we don't have the privilege, we call our children for lunch and all. But earlier when we used to be in our parents' house, come for lunch, we'll see that this, I don't want that, I'm not hungry. Looking at the items, we will decide whether we are hungry or no. So don't do that. Please, whatever is cooked at home, that wholesome thali or that wholesome meal or that wholesome breakfast, our beautiful traditional Indian breakfasts, which keep us full, you know, please start with that and do not keep yourself hungry for long periods of time. The minute you keep yourself hungry for long periods of time, the craving sets in and you invariably want to eat something which gives you instant gratification, like a burger or anything, you know. So that is the first thing. Drink plenty of water. Most of the time when we are not hydrated, we feel hungry and our body mistakes thirst to be hunger. So trust me that whenever you start feeling hungry, just drink half a bottle of water. Anyway, you have to drink about 2 to 3 liters of water a day. So first drink water, little bit of the hunger pangs will go down, and keep drinking water throughout the day to ward off hunger. The third thing is, by drinking water, you'll be many of us say, I don't want to drink water because I keep running to the loo. But then that's a form of exercise, right? You'll be burning some calories. So think about the positive side of that too. You should eat more protein in your meals. They have found out through research that if you increase your protein intake by 25%, your hunger decreases by 60%. So what are the protein foods? Dals, eggs, meats, fish. A little substantial part of protein should be there in every meal so that you don't feel hungry for the next meal, rather than it being a complete carbohydrate list. And proteins are there in every food of ours, like sambar, dal, you know, paneer, everything, you know. So eat a bit of, consciously eat protein in your meals every time. You can also practice avoiding hunger pangs by keeping out of sight is out of mind. Don't keep looking at pictures of yummy, delicious food, you know. People, we get all that satisfaction by seeing. And have you noticed when we see that, we instantly remember, oh, I've not had cake for a long time. And now though everybody is baking cakes and I don't know, cake has become the, the most go after food area. So just to keep yourself busy, cultivate a hobby. And if you keep yourself busy, you will not crave for food so much. These are some of the tips. And stock, when you at home, keep plenty of fruits, anything available. Even if you go for work, keep an apple or a banana in your purse. So when you feel hungry, munch on an apple. So whatever is available, you usually grab that. So see to make things easy for you. Wherever in your house, you should have fruits and vegetables and cucumbers and carrots, you know, all these very low calorie foods, watermelons, all that. So invariably your hand goes to reach out to that. And also sleep on time. They have said that if you have sleep deprived, which most of our younger generation is watching social media for long periods, including me. So then when we are sleep deprived, hunger sets in more. That is the research which has been proved. So try to follow all these small tips and it's always the mind over the matter. You have to control your mind. And for that, Mrs. Radha Bhatt will tell us, mental strength is the most important thing, I think, to practice good yoga, even to practice good nutrition, mental strength is very important. Thank you.
Thank you, Pratibha.
Sharmila, I hope I have answered. Yeah,
that was very well said, Pratibha. And you have covered all the points, and I'm sure we promise you to eat good, healthy food sleep on time and eat in intervals. We do agree with you, Pratibha. Thanks okay. a lot. Thank you. So can we go with the next question? Requesting the panelists due to the paucity of time to keep it short and crisp, because we have another panel discussion which is coming up. So the next question is, this is from Toastmaster Sulata Pai, and she has three daughters at home. So this is it's very related to her, I believe. Most schools have reopened now. After nearly 2 years of being at home, children find it tough to get back. So children are finding it tough to get back. So I think this is a question for Radha ma'am. They are anxious as they are unvaccinated and feel vulnerable. How can we as parents reassure and help them? So she's requesting Radha Bhatt to answer her question. Over to you, Radha.
Thank you, Kavita. Actually, the question is valid, not only for children, for all of us. But here, as she's been very specific about school-going children, I would like to answer on that. Definitely, children who are not vaccinated are exposed and more vulnerable. But how do we motivate them? With positive reassurances, and we have to tell them how much they're going to enjoy the school, their friends, their teachers, that atmosphere and environment, and we have to remind them how boring it is to stay at home and attend the online classes. So we have to tell them what is rewarding in the school so that the children are not anxious and stressed to go to school. And the moment the child's anxiety and stress is down, definitely their immunity is better, they eat better, they sleep better, overall their general health is better. And second thing is, which is very common, is we as parents, we discuss everything in front of children. And again, now because of the pandemic, all of us are together. So please don't pass on your apprehensions, your fear. Don't speak about it. Don't highlight it in front of the children. No adult talks in front of the children. And don't keep giving them all the data. Okay, in Kerala, so many cases are happening. The different variants are coming. Because children know, we need not make them anxious. And as it is now, children have lost their childhood. So we have to create a positive environment. So first thing is we have to limit our talking, the adult talks, and creating unnecessary panic. And school, we have to give a very positive image about the school and why it is important for them to go. Because most of the children, especially the school-going primary children, they come to my clinic, they have lost their language skills, they have lost their arithmetic skills, and they don't have the patience of even sitting for 20 minutes at a stretch. So the concentration, comprehension, everything is coming down. So definitely they need to go to school, they have to get back to their routine. So we have to constantly give them positive reassurance and encourage them and ask them to open up once they are back about whatever they are worried about and whatever their fear is about. I think that way we should be able to send them back to school. Please let us not pass our insecurity to the children.
Thanks a lot, Radha. That was a very valid point. The next question is from Toastmasters Gladys Montero, who's from our club. She says, pranayama is said to relieve our tension and lift off spirits. But it is very difficult when compared to the asanas. How do we calm our mind and meditate? This is for you, Reshma.
Yes, Kavita. So coming back to the question, so there are different steps to the yoga, and asana comes under the third step. So asana is not only about the physical movement of your body, but it is also the connection with the breath. So when you're getting into the posture and when you're trying to connect yourself with the breath, you're again training your mind and body to focus on the breathing. And then when you come, which will lead you to the next step, which is the pranayama. So when you come, so it is over a period of time training your body into different kind of a asana. When you're trying to, you know, correlate it with the breathing, then you come into your next step, that is the pranayama. And that's where you are again now totally focusing, you're sitting quietly, you're focusing on your breathing pattern. Here the object is the breath. So it's okay. Initially, you know, you might find it a little, just like, you know, the asanas, as soon as you get into it, you don't immediately get your postures right. It's like over a period of time of intense practicing, you start getting it right. So even pranayama, the same way, you keep practicing it. And, you know, you there is a day when you will definitely, you know, be able to calm your mind. It is just a process which happens very slowly and gently. And this is what I think yoga also teaches us, to be patient, you know, be patient with the entire thing. When you're patient, you definitely, you know, achieve what you want to achieve. And there's no forcing of your mind or your body. And once you conquer the pranayama, once you do, you know, you get better in your breathing, you reach the next step, which is like, you know, comes at the end. That is the meditation, which is like, you know, not at the subconscious level, but you are trying to connect yourself with the superconscious level. Which is like, you know, you reach at a much, much later stage. But even at the beginning of, you know, just doing it for some time, you definitely find some kind of a change. You don't have to get really jitters like, oh, I'm not getting it right. I'm not able to, you know, calm myself. It is over a period of time, you know, as you continue with the journey, you're able to, you know, conquer it and you're able to get it. Yeah, so that's that.
Thank you, Reshma. Thank you so much for investing your precious time with us. My sincere thanks to the panelists and the audience. It has been such an enriching experience and a great takeaway for all of us. You have created an awareness amongst us. Thank you for giving us such a valuable information. To achieve lasting health, we need to understand the importance of body, mind, and soul, and how they work together to build our overall well-being. A healthy body keeps you well and active. A healthy mind keeps you focused and engaged. A healthy soul keeps you fulfilled and content. So, the rhythm of the body, the melody of the mind, and the harmony of the soul creates the symphony of life. Hope this session has added value to your life. A special thanks to Toastmaster Ranjini for the diligently doing the timer's role. Thank you, Ranjini. And also to Toastmaster Shraddha to compare the program with these. And a special shout out to our very own president, who's not here today, that is of Mangalore Toastmasters, and that is Toastmaster Sunita. And last but not the least, the dynamic Toastmaster Yonel, who's always there to step in even at the last moment. We will answer your questions later if you have put them on the chat box. I'm sorry, because of lack of time, we couldn't answer them. Signing off, it was a pleasure being the moderator today. Thank you.
Being the mother of two teenagers, when initially lockdown was announced, I've seen the excitement in the kids because it was something new we never heard of. Lockdown, sitting inside the house all the time, not able to going out. But as the time passed, I've seen that excitement turning into sadness and after a year, slowly into depression. And they were eagerly waiting when things will get back to normal. When will we go and have that normal social life, meet our friends? So I'm sure this panel discussion helped many mothers like me to deal such situation, how to control our own emotions for the sake of our family. So thank you, Toastmaster Kavita, for conducting this useful, valuable panel discussion. And I'm sure most of the Toastmasters will benefit from those tips from our panelists. Now, many of us sitting inside, still not going out, sitting inside home, how to change into positive thing? So how to make more money? Now we know how to control our mind, body, and soul. Now let us learn to control our finance also, how to take that rein in our hand and can do more online shopping to earn more money so that we can do more online shopping. For that, we have our second panel discussion, which is moderated by none other than distinguished Toastmaster Winston, who never failed to inspire us, who is always enthusiastic. So, sir, we have lots to learn from you. The subject topic for the panel discussion is achieving financial freedom, how to make money work for you. So I don't take much time now. Sir, shall we start our second panel discussion?
Yeah, sure. I'm ready.
Over to you, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Shraddha, for that nice and lovely small introduction. I have been a banker for almost 30 years. I worked for Citibank and ABN AMRO Bank. So I spent most of my life in finance. But now my topic is how to achieve financial freedom and how to make your money work for you. Now, financial freedom, what I mean is initially we all have jobs and we get a salary. So we can spend whatever you want. And so you have that financial freedom. But we never think of long term. Once you start life, you are a bachelor, then you get married, you get children. But then after some years, you have to provide for your children's education, which is now very expensive. If you want to send them abroad, it's minimum. Just 2 days back, my nephew went to US and she said $40,000 a year. So this is very expensive. You have to provide for this. You have to provide for this. The other one is for the marriage of your children. Okay, that is also now marriages are competitive like, and so you have to spend a lot of money. And the last one is your retirement. Eventually after 60, you are not able to work or you have to retire. Then there is no income coming in, there is only expenditure. So how do you provide for all this? First of all, for saving, you have to control your expenses. I would suggest it is better to keep a track of your expenses for at least six months initially and see where you spend extra money. Like one small example is when you come to the office, you have lunch in a restaurant which is costing you. Instead of that, you bring dry lunch and then you can save some money. Those are small things you can save. The next one is you have this provident fund and the employer contributes the same certain amount, maximum amount. So your contribution has to be maximum so that the employer also contributes that much money and you can get advantage of that. That's the provident fund. So it is keeps on growing. It keeps on compounding. Then whatever extra you have got, you have to start saving. Mostly what we do is we put our money in deposits. When we are young, we think, oh, deposits are safe. They are in the bank anytime we want to take. But there is a concept called inflation. Now the inflation is around 5%. And the interest rate, what you get is 5% or some banks even give lower than that. So whatever interest you earn is eaten up by the inflation. So what you have to do is you have to find some other avenues of investment where once you invest, your money grows without your interference. It keeps on growing, whether you do anything. You, like they say, when you sleep, your mind works. The same way that when you invest, your money works, somebody else works for you and you get the benefit of it. So what are the other ways? Investments can be in shares. That is equities, we call it equities. You can open a DMAT account and buy shares. So equities, what I said, equities are, some equities are risky, some are not so risky. So you have to select which equities you want to invest in. Maybe you can invest in blue chip companies where your money is safe. So that's the third. And the second one is mutual funds. This concept of mutual fund has arisen maybe about 25 years back. This is a financial institution takes your money and invest in different kinds of shares, the mutual funds. They may be technology, all in technology, all in heavy machinery, all in gas and oil. So there are different types of mutual funds. So the financial advisor will select for you according to your goals. And normally when you invest in these mutual funds, you have to have a long-term view, not a short-term 2 or 3 years, but you must have a view of at least, I would say long-term is 5-10 years at least. Then what happens is this mutual funds, when you get dividends, you reinvest. So it becomes a cumulative effect. And what I have seen from my mutual fund investment, they have grown maybe for the last 30 years, for the last 25 years, they have grown at the rate of 12% compounded, which is a really substantial amount. So by my investing in these mutual funds, I am now comfortable with my financial responsibility. There is another avenue also, investing in gold or investing in real estate. If you invest in real estate, you have to have a larger capital, and then you have to make sure you have the proper title for the property and it is not encroached. So, but I would say that real estate, with my experience and with my friend's experience, have really paid very well. One of my cousin who had invested in 2001 in a property in a society in Yelahanka, Bangalore, he paid 20 lakhs of rupees at that time. And just before the lockdown, he sold the property for a massive amount of 4 crores. Just imagine 20 lakhs of investment and the return is 4 crores. But he had to wait for 21 years. So these are the things you can invest in. But since we are not experts, many of us are not experts, it is better to go to a financial advisor who will plan your taxes and see your overall situation and then advise you how to invest. So now I have selected 3 panelists who will now be available for questioning. I will introduce them one by one. First is Dr. Sukanya Rao. She holds a PhD in behavioral finance from NITK Suratkal. At present, she is a financial service professional offering guidance in personal investment and insurance. She is also an associate professor at the Department of Business Administration at Sahyadri College. She is a yoga and meditation enthusiast and enjoys reading during her leisure time. That is Sukanya for you. The second one is Chandrasekhar. Mr. Chandrasekhar is working as a traffic assistant, a traffic manager at NMPT for the last 20 years. Basically, he is a civil engineer with M.Tech from NITK and MBA from IGNO. He did his PhD in diploma in investment management from St. Helvetius College. He is a long-time investor, so he has got a lot of experience in investing in stocks and mutual funds, and I understand he has been very successful. His hobbies are filmy songs and reading inspirational books. Then the last one is Yonel D'Souza. He is an investment service professional based in the city of Mangalore. He is passionate about personal finance and interacting with keen minds on the topic of money management. He is an alumnus of St. Helvetius College, Mangalore, with a degree in BCom and MBA. He also has a keen interest in getting to the root of the procrastination and helps himself and people around him in bridging knowledge versus action gap. So I have selected all these people who are our Toastmaster members so that later on, if you want to consult them, it is easier for you to consult them. And I'm sure they will guide you successfully. Now, I open the floor for action, for questions. Anybody would like to ask a question is free to go ahead.
Hello.
Yeah.
This is Avin here.
Yes, Avin.
I had a question regarding investing in the equity market right now, because a lot of people are talking about investing in equity market, but personally I feel that the equity markets are pretty expensive. They're hitting all-time highs, and would it make more sense to exit out of the equity market and get invested in the debt market? And since it is very expensive to get into the equity market, it's very pricey. There can be a correction in the market, the prices can fall. So would it be better to exit out of the equity market, get into the debt market, and when the correction happens or prices crash, then get into the equity market when the prices are cheaper? Would that be advisable?
Thank you, Avin. It's a very good question and it's an appropriate question. I would request Mr. Chandrasekhar, who is an expert in investment in equities, to answer this question, please.
Yeah, happy to answer this. The thing is, we cannot predict the market as well. When it will fall, and how much it can raise. The best thing is, if you want to invest in the equity market, there is equity market has got time horizon of 5 years. If you can hold it for 5 years of a time, if you don't need that money, then only you can go for equity. Otherwise, you should not go for equity. Because minimum, at what time it will fall, nobody knows. The thing is, in the short term, you cannot predict the market. But in the long term, always the equity will definitely raise. When you see the history of 200 years of stock market, we can see that over the period of time, always the market will go up. But in the short term, we cannot predict it. Now, already market is high. When the correction will come, nobody knows. But the thing is, if you have money, but if you can wait for 5 years of time, even if the market falls, again it will rise, because the bear and this bull market will be of 2.5 years. I think if your time horizon is 5 years, you can certainly go ahead with the stocks.
Thank you, Mr. Chandrasekhar. Mr. Avin?
Yes, Mr. Avin.
Thank you. I think you can hear.
Yes, yes.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Chandrasekhar. Mr. Avin, I hope you are happy with the answers, because you can never say when the stock market falls or when. The more you keep longer invest, you get dividends and you get bonus. So that is the advantage of compounded benefit. Okay, can we go to a next question? Anybody else would like to ask?
Can I ask one, Naya Winston?
Yeah, welcome, Della.
It is Kavita.
Kavita.
So you can
Della raise the hand, or Della, you go ahead.
Yeah, you go.
Della, go ahead, please.
Okay, thank you, Winston. I wanted to find out if it is advisable from the financial advisors here, whether it is advisable to consult one financial advisor for equity and shares and mutual funds, or two separate financial advisors. So what is your view on this?
You're going to say one advisor for shares and equities and one for mutual funds. Yeah, who will answer it?
I'll take it up.
UNL will take it up, yes. Please.
So when it comes to personal finance, it's more personal than finance. So when you have an advisor, it's always advisable to have one single advisor. The reason is he'll have a holistic idea about your investments. He'll have a holistic idea of what are your objectives. And those objectives have to be matched with your investments. So when it comes to advice part, it's always better to have one single advisor. And when it comes to services, you can take services of maybe a different broker or different entity as well. But advice part, it's always good to have a single advisor. And I would like to make an important point here, especially when it comes to the financial services industry. It's very difficult to pick the right advisor. This is a challenge for most of the investors. I would like to make a point here as to how exactly you can understand if the advisor is thinking in your interest or no, because the financial services industry is in such a way that products are sold rather than bought. So it's important to know whether the advisor is thinking in your interest or no. So here I will give you a simple, maybe a tip as to how exactly you know if he's thinking in your interest. During the conversation, if at all the advisor is talking maybe about you or about your goals, about your objectives, and if the emphasis is very less on the product, then I'm sure the advisor is thinking in your interest. But if the advisor in the conversation, if the advisor is predominantly talking about the product and not about you, there is an incentive involved, and I don't really think the advisor may be talking in your interest. So this is one of the ways that you can figure out whether the advisor is to pick the right advisor. So that's all I have to say. Any questions?
Okay, Della. I think Mr. Yonel has explained to the best of his abilities. I'm sure you are satisfied with his answers, and I would also suggest that you take one advisor so that he knows the overall position of your financial system. Okay, any more questions, please? Kavita, go ahead.
Yes, Winston. Thank you.
Please go ahead.
My question is that we have something called investments in bank FDs, bank accounts. And we have something called the shares or the equities. And we have something like insurance, and we have sectors of investments. So how could we balance that, as the bank rate interests have pretty much come down, but the risk in equity is too much. And of course, insurance sector is very necessary, as they say. How do you balance on your investment? How a layman can balance on his investment? Could you throw light on this for me?
Yeah. See, this is also a very relevant question which most of the people ask, novices ask. And I think Sukanya is the right person, because she is also expert in insurance and equities and mutual funds. Sukanya, would you please go ahead and explain to it?
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yes, clear.
Okay, thank you. So what happens is FDs are safe. So what you do is, first you need to develop a plan for yourself. So you create a fund which is called an emergency fund. Now, emergency is something that you fall back on in case of an emergency, as it says. So normally what we say is you have your 6 to 12 months of income, monthly income in that emergency fund. So you keep that in the bank FDs so that in case something happens to you and you're not able to earn an income, you still have some money to fall back on. So you can keep that in the FDs. Now, whatever is long term, so beyond 5 years, let's say, because, Winston also mentioned equities are risky. So normally you plan for the long term in equities, but for the short term, whatever money you need, you don't put them in equities. All right. You either keep them in FDs or you can choose some debt mutual funds, highly liquid debt mutual funds. So you can distribute between FDs and the liquid mutual funds. Now, when it comes to insurance is specifically for risk cover. So you buy a term life insurance and you buy a health insurance, absolutely necessary, because anything can happen anytime. And in case you fall ill or you meet with an accident and you get hospitalized, generally, you know, the healthcare costs are increasing and they're not increasing at the normal inflationary level. So they're increasing at very high percentages every year. So 10 years ago, if you went to a hospital, your bill would have, been less. But today, if you walk into a hospital for a week and come out, your bill is about a lakh of rupees. So that is why health insurance is absolutely necessary. Insure the entire family for health insurance. And a term life insurance is very important for earning members of the family, because in case something happens to you and you're not able to earn, you know, at least the family is not put into inconvenience or discomfort, and they're able to continue their, similar lifestyle, or, they have some money corpus to fall back on. So that is why you need a term life insurance and a health insurance. Equities for the long term and FDs for short term funds. So back to you, Winston.
Okay, I'm okay. Yes, Sukanya. Sorry, I can't hear you.
Sukanya, you're on mute.
Okay. Sorry, I finished. Now you go ahead.
Okay. Any more questions? We have a little more time.
Yeah, I have one. As Toastmaster Chandru said, equity is risky. So if you have money, is it advisable to invest in gold bond? Because as we observed that gold prices have increased, not exponentially, but definitely, yes, positively it increased over a period of time. So is it advisable to invest in gold bond?
Yeah, there should be a mixture of investment. Like you must have stocks, mutual fund, and about 10% you can always go with gold related funds, because gold also over the period what we have seen is it can beat the inflation comfortably. So I think part of your investment can definitely can you go with the gold bonds. Over to Shraddha. Hope I answered your question.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Chandrasekhar, and thank you, Shraddha. Any more questions?
Yeah, I have a question. Royal D'Souza here. Yeah. What about cryptocurrencies? Is it a good place to invest?
I think Yonil is the right person to answer.
Okay. So when it comes to cryptocurrency, the thing is, rather than trying to answer that question, we need to ask more questions. And if at all we do not really, for everything, we do not really need to have an answer. So if we do not get the right answers for the questions, then we can avoid investing in cryptocurrencies. The first question that I would like to ask is it an asset class or is it a currency? So we still have the rupees, we still have the dollars. I would still bank on that, and rather, I do not really need a cryptocurrency to buy bread in the morning. So I wouldn't consider that as a currency. Even an asset class, I wouldn't really consider it as an asset class, because equity or shares in a company gives you profits. Real estate gives you rent. But what does a Bitcoin do? I do not really see it as an income generating asset. So I wouldn't really consider it as an asset class as well. So I still do not have an answer for what does a Bitcoin or a cryptocurrency produce. So again, I do not have an answer. I would like to eliminate that. And another question that I would like to ask is, why is the price of Bitcoin going up, or why is the price of Bitcoin going down? And if you try to analyze, or you ask, you get hold of any person on the road and ask, why is the price of Bitcoin going up? And he would say, because people are buying. Then you ask another question, why are people buying? So people will say that because the price is going up. So why is the price going up? Because people are buying. Why are people buying? Because the price is going up. So it goes in a similar fashion. And when the prices are falling, why is the price falling? Because people are selling. Why are people selling? Price is falling. So it doesn't really have an intrinsic aspect there. And that's the reason I still do not, wouldn't like to consider it as an investment, neither as a currency. So I would like to stay away from it for now. I hope I've answered that.
Okay. Thank you, Yonel. And thank you, Royal D'Souza, for the question. This is a question which I also asked my financial advisor. He says, I don't know anything about cryptocurrency. It's for me, it's something new. You don't go when it is something new unless you understand what it is and you have a track record for it. Never jump into something when somebody tells you. If somebody gives you a tip and you invest in it, that is the time you dip. So be very careful. Don't go on somebody else's tips. Investigate, find out why you have to invest. Is it safe? Because it is your hard-earned money. Friends, money is very difficult to get through now because of this pandemic and recession. Though the stock market is going up, there's a lot of unemployment. So we are all not being younger again. We are becoming older and older. So our intention is to save money. As I told you, though I had 30 years of experience, till I was 45, I did not save in equities or mutual funds. I was happy with the deposits because that time interest rate was about 10-12%. Okay, but I attended a lecture from a financial advisor and his topic was build your nest. Build your nest. Like the birds build a nest. When there is rain, they go into it. When they have to lay eggs, they go into it. So that's a safe place. So he says, you build your nest for your retirement. So that will free you from all financial problems. Once there is financial problems, then you don't have peace of mind. So friends, I would advise you, when you want, start investing now. Don't think you are too young or too old. It's not the age or not the time of the stock market that you invest. Its time is now. If you have not started, start now. Even a small amount, you can start investing on a monthly basis. You don't have to put a lump sum. You can start investing on a monthly basis, but you have proper financial discipline. This is what my advisor told me. You have proper financial discipline. If you have decided to invest 20,000 a month, stick to that 20,000. Don't say 1 month I'll put 10,000, 1 month 20, and next month I'll put 30. Stick to that discipline. And when you said your goal is a long term for 10 years, stick to that 10 years. Do not go and liquidate it. I want to buy a car, so I will liquidate this and then I can start again. No, that is not the investment discipline. Stick to your goal. And I'm sure the money will start working for you. Always the compounded result is the best. Because like when you buy mutual funds, you don't take dividends. You say reinvest your dividends because your dividends are reinvested. Again, they also say stocks, if you get dividend, better to reinvest. But it is difficult to reinvest the stocks. So if you can, you can reinvest. But when you buy stocks, as I told you, many of the companies, good companies, give you dividends, good dividends they give. plus bonus share. That is a real benefit for you, which keeps on multiplying. And I'm sure those who have invested from the last 10 or 20 years have really, because the stock market was something like 21,000 in, what was it, 2012. Am I right, Yolin?
2008, it was 21.
2008, it was 21. And now see where it has reached. It has reached to 59,000. Unbelievable. And it is not going to stop there. There may be a depression or stock market may go up, but it will similarly, same way the graph, what goes down has to come up. That is always the principle of investment. Okay, go ahead, Sukanya.
Okay. So my topic is about why financial planning is necessary for women. First of all, let me tell you, a man is not a financial plan. So don't depend on men for your money. Please earn your own money, number one. Number two, if you look at the life expectancy, women live longer than men. Look at your own families. You will have more aged women in your household who are maybe single, widowed, and so on, and lesser men. So we live longer than men. So definitely we need to understand money better. And most of the time, children and maybe teenagers always approach their mothers for money. They don't ask their fathers. So we need to have a plan. Moreover, as women, we are responsible for the household budgets. And another thing is, generally, when we have to take care of the elderly, either the parents, grandparents, or in-laws, it's our responsibility. So we have to be very judicious with the money that we have while planning the household budget. And that is why it's absolutely important for women to have their own source of income. And another thing is, when we talk of empowerment, when we have money, we are economically empowered. But when you start earning your own money, you're also socially empowered because you can make your own decisions. So when you want to buy something, like Shraddha started with, you know, wanting to shop online. Well, if you have to depend on your husband's money all the time, then he might say, how much are you shopping or something like that. So when you have your own income, you save, of course, like how Winston said. But at the end of the day, when you have some extra money, you can decide what you want to buy. So you don't have to depend on others. So absolutely important for women to have some source of income. And because we are responsible for a lot of things. So with responsibility, also get the authority. So thank you so much. Back to you, Winston.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Now I call upon Chandrasekhar to summarize his views in a short, not more than 2 minutes. Chandrasekhar, please.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Good evening, everyone. As our moderator, Winston D'Souza, said, the one of the best avenue for investment is the stock market. And the best part of the stock market is that it, what you have seen is it has consistently beaten the inflation and has given good return. So it is the one of the genuine investment avenue for the long-term investors. Short-term, we cannot predict the market, but long-term, definitely shares will rise. The common investors have a doubt how to invest in stock market. They think that market studies to be done, accounts knowledge must be there. It is not our cup of tea, but it is not like that. There are only six simple rules and a recommendation. This what I learned from Mr. Gerald Kelloso when I have did the financial planning investment management diploma. He has taught about this, how to investment do in shares market. He says that six rule, that is diversify across the 10 or 20 sector, select only blue chips and allocate equal amount to in each sector, reinvest the dividend and review your portfolio, and time horizon is 5 years. And to give an example, during this COVID period, I have invested about 1.3 lakhs in the 13 different stocks. So, and today what I can see, this 1.3 has gone up to 3.25 lakhs. That means here, this you can see here in the Shraddha has shared the screen. See, the purchase is from April, March to June, in the when there was a dip in the market. So I have invested roughly 10,000. The rule number 3 says equal amount, and different sectors are there: cement, steel, grass, bank, and software. Different. I mean, there is a diversification. So I have bought rate also I have given, and this is the present rate on the last 21st this month. So present value you can see over there. Some stocks have gone 10,000 has become 20,000, 13,000. I mean, even some stock Tata Consumer has gone up to 63,000. So you can see here different. I mean, in less than 11, 18 months, these stocks have given about. It has raised up to 2.5 times. So that is the advantage of investing in stocks. I'm sure if this bull run will goes up, you cannot imagine how. I mean, what would be this value?
Yeah, thank you very much. Dear audience, you can always consult Chandrasekhar. He is our Toastmaster member and is always available. So also Sukanya and Yonil. Now, Yonil, can you please summarize your talk within 2 minutes, please?
Okay, sure. So when it comes to finance can be looked at in two levels. So one is finance at the macro level, and finance at the micro level. For example, finance at the macro level is indeed complicated. For example, drafting the Union Budget of India, it's just not possible for a layperson. But finance at the micro level, like the personal level, at the level of you and me, it is extremely simple. It's not complicated at all. Anyone can master it. So what an investor needs to do is just focus on like few things, just around 5 or 7 things. If he focuses, gets it right, I'm sure the odds are in his favor to achieve financial freedom. Rest is all about avoiding costly mistakes. Similar to what Pratibha said, try to keep it simple when it comes to health. Try to keep it simple. The rest is all about not doing it. So similarly, that's what applies to personal finance. The first point that you need to do is have an emergency fund. As Sukanya said, at least 12 months of your living expenses should be set aside for emergencies. Last in March 2020, I'm sure the ones who had an emergency fund were less panicked, a little less than the ones who didn't have. So that's rule number one, invest in a liquid fund for your emergencies. Second thing, retirement fund. Okay, now people like Royal, who are pretty young, will wonder why is this fellow talking about a retirement fund. But let me give a walking, talking example here. We have Winston D'Souza. He's almost 50 years older to us, like older to me. And I think the first 30 years that he worked, he worked for money. And now you can actually see money working for him. And if you hear Toastmaster Winston's speeches, he has had fun for the past 20, 22 years because money is working for him. So start your retirement fund as early as possible. Then you will see a day where money will work for you. And when it comes to retirement fund, do not invest in bank fixed deposits. Consider investing in equities. For example, let's say, when I say equity, you have a Nifty index fund, you have a Nifty Next 50 index fund. These funds have companies like, for example, HDFC Bank, Asian Paints, Britannia, Reliance Industries. So you are owning a piece of the company, even let's say an MRF. And all these companies we consume on a day-to-day basis. Everyone here consumes. It's not only about us, the entire country consumes the goods and services. By investing in equity, you are owning these companies. So you are basically, let's say a Mukesh Ambani is managing money for you. Okay, so to that extent, you can consider that. And another important point that I would like to mention here is companies like Facebook, Amazon, Apple, Google, we consume on a day-to-day basis, but in the Indian markets, it's not listed. Mutual funds makes it possible. Sitting here in India, even with as less as 1,000 rupees, you can invest in the US stock markets. So mutual funds make it possible. So it depends upon how exactly you go about. That's all I have to say. And the final point that I would like to mention here is, if it's possible, save at least 40% of your income. Okay, if at all you do that, and if you invest in the right place, if you sow the seed in the right soil, odds are in your favor to achieve financial freedom. And we always have a Toastmaster Winston to look up to and be inspired from. Toastmaster Winston, over to you.
Okay. Now, just to conclude, I found this participation from the audience was very encouraging. And also, our panelists who are experts in this line have given their opinion. Hopefully, it is useful for all of you. First of all, I have to thank Shraddha for conducting this whole meeting. And then Toastmaster Ranjani for being the timer. She has done it very efficiently, though within a short period. I told her only yesterday. And I also thank the audience for showing interest and asking questions, which are very useful and which will help each one of you. Friends, I would conclude by saying, if you have not started your investment, do not delay. Start now, it is too late in the night. Start tomorrow morning. And we have got 3 advisors. You can go to them. Plus, we have got another advisor, Sapna, who is also advising on investments. If you do not like them, you have always an option to go to somebody else. There are a lot of financial advisors around in Mangalore city. But when you select a good one, ask somebody else's opinion, whether they have invested with them and whether they are happy. So I wish you all a happy financial freedom time during your retirement time. Thank you. And over to you, Shraddha.
Thank you, distinguished Toastmaster Winston. So if I can summarize this panel discussion, I learned that don't put your eggs in single basket. Keep it in at different places so that at least you can save few eggs for later use. So thank you, Toastmaster Kavita, for conducting and feeding our mind, body, and soul with some positive input. And thank you to distinguished Toastmaster Winston for conducting a panel discussion on achieving financial freedom. I know many of ladies homemakers like us can make use of those important tips. So once again, I thank all the panelists, Radha Bhatt, Reshma Kariyappa, and Pratibha Kamath, as well as Sukanya, Toastmaster Yonil, and Toastmaster Chandrashekhar for taking part as the panelists, and moderator Toastmaster Kavita and DTM Winston for conducting those two panel discussion. Officially, I close the meeting.